This week, U.S. equities roared even higher with the NASDAQ above 8,100 for the first time in U.S. market history. Well, welcome back, everyone. Your host, Chris Waltzik, here with you on this August 31st show, Season 13, Episode 659 edition. Two more big guest interviews with the topicality including the precious metals capitulation. Have we finally found that elusive bottom? Or are we getting close? Nick Barashev says so. From Bullion Management Group, top precious metals storage company, the author of $10,000 Gold, he outlines exactly why it's inevitable. He likens the U.S. to a Venezuela, Argentina, Brazil, Iran, South Africa, and even Turkey-style currency crisis on the horizon. Eventually, $300 trillion will start to look for a safe haven in a tiny $1.8 trillion market compared to $300 trillion, sending gold to $10,000, $20,000, $30,000, and perhaps even higher on panic buying. Several BRICS nations are already inoculating their currency from the threat of the financial infection, China and Russia leading the pack. Plus, Peter Grandich and company says he's pushed his portfolio into the precious metals. Just about a year or two ago when stocks were cheaper, he told folks to diversify, but not now. Gold and silver is all he's thinking about. And remember to sign up for the Alpha Stocks newsletter while we're having this promotion. You can have all the weekly stock candidates, including gold and silver stocks, that tend to outperform the equities markets, plus the free crypto giveaway. And the Q&A hotline, 641-715-3900, followed by extension number 514049. GoldSeek.com radio begins now with a market weather recap. Partly cloudy skies appeared over the precious metals sector this week, but gold did hold support above 1,200 on a three-week dollar rout. At Friday's closing bell, gold finished off just 650 an ounce at 1206. Silver shed 36 cents at 1444, while the XEU precious metals index dropped $1.44, ending at 6624. However, black gold added 350. Closing just shy of $70. And the Bitcoin ETF added about 30 cents at $9.50, just slightly over support, up 3.5%. The top story moving the precious metals sector this week, the trade war continued to boost demand for commodities and crude oil, as well as gold on Friday, amid a continued U.S. dollar slump. Washington warned China to prepare for further trade tariffs, with some saber-rattling of $200 billion more in as soon as next week, according to a Bloomberg report on Thursday. The two countries have already imposed $50 billion of tariffs on each other's exports just in the last 6 months. In response, the Chinese government warned the United States about protracted trade war if it continued to place tariffs and taxes on goods. In related news, Washington rejected an offer from the European Union economic ministers who sought zero tariffs on their auto exports. The president noted that the EU policymakers were almost as bad as our other big trade partner, threatening to withdraw the U.S. from the World Trade Organization unless folks shape up. Meanwhile, the Fed is putting more pressure on the precious metals as Fed Chairman Jerome Powell spoke of additional rate increases due to domestic inflation. And we saw some inflation crop up in the recent numbers. The U.S. Central Bank is now set for at least two more rate hikes this year and another two more in early 2019, according to the Fed Funds Futures contracts at the St. Louis Fed website, which show about 98.4% probability of another hike in the overnight lending rate at the next Fed meeting, September 25th and 26th, to 200 basis points, not at the November meeting, but again at December, up to 225 basis points, looks likely. Bottom line, precious metals. Well, the U.S. dollar pullback did little to encourage precious metals bulls. However, black gold, Bitcoin, and the CRB were strong, which may bode well for the metals in the coming weeks with holiday buying just around the corner. Moving on to the Wall Street Report, visibility virtually unlimited over the U.S. equities markets with the tech-laden index at yet another all-time high, well over 8,000, even 8,100. On solid economic reports, the Dow Jones picked up 174, up over 0.5%, finishing just shy of 26,000. And the S&P 500 picked up 27, ending at 2901, while that amazing NASDAQ picked up 164, ending at 8,100. 109. The big story pushing the equities higher Tuesday, an agreement between the United States and Mexico to overhaul NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement. Canada actually joined into the talks, which was a big plus for equities investors, to be part of the trilateral pact named the United States-Mexico Trade Agreement, scheduled to last for 16 years, but under review every 6 years. The Labor Department reported that the number of American people filing for unemployment benefits did inch higher a bit, but it was better than expected, with the monthly average claims falling by 1,500 to 212,000, the lowest since 1969, the year yours truly entered terra firma. The good news was compounded by reports from the Bureau of Economic Analysis that U.S. consumer spending has increased, the fifth monthly increase, while personal income also climbed to a 12-month high. The Fed policymakers' favorite measure of inflation, the core index, also climbed a bit. Altogether, as friendly for U.S. shares, not too hot, not too cold environment, just right for corporate growth, suggesting the Fed would likely halt its rate hike program by as soon as the middle of next year. Interesting U.S. stocks in the news, including Netflix, up 1.1%, on track, we think, for much higher in the months ahead. Amazon, AMZN, gained fractionally. It's one of Zach's top-ranked strong buy shares. And Apple stock increased about 1%. U.S. shares, bottom line. Well, as anticipated in the last report, the new highs continue to move in because the herd is still rushing to get back into shares. That is according to the 7 indicator USA Today Greed to Fear Index. The pendulum is starting to get overextended, but there's still more room for higher highs. One proviso, we're starting to see some excessive technicals here, which suggests that prices may be short-term a bit frothy. Coming up after the break, more Gold Seek Radio. It's always a pleasure to welcome back Peter Grandich, a Wall Street wizard from Peter Grandich and Company, with his thoughts this week on all the markets, including our favorite precious metals, as well as U.S. equities. Welcome back.
Thank you, Chris.
The top story moving the markets last week, people were a little bit surprised, I think, by, the president's comments against Jerome Powell. I mean, after all, he appointed Jerome Powell to the Federal Reserve. He's not happy, our president, with higher interest rates. He thinks that could put a crimp on our exports. He wants U.S. exports to remain strong. So far, some of their strategies seem to be working.
Well, I think Trump recognizes that what is keeping him, his head above water, so to speak, is the strength of the economy, or at least the perceived strength of the economy. If for some reason that would falter to any great degree, I think the anti-Trump movement would grab more traction and cause more heartache than it presently does for him. So it's critical in his eyes, and I think those who are supporters of the president, to maintain a strong, or at least a perception of a strong economy. You bring out a very good point. The very fact of the man that you appointed is not working out, and the same could be said for his attorney general, which I have a feeling he's going to actually dismiss to cause more media fodder. But, he's made a lot of appointments that have not turned out the way he claimed he hoped, but soon or later the people start to say it may not be the people you're choosing, but the method of the person that's choosing them. So I do think that the comments may help the market at the moment, but internally, and of course, behind closed doors among central bankers, I don't think it's liked by them, and especially Powell, though you're never going to hear him say that publicly, that the president, should be minding his business and let him take care of what he thinks his business is.
While he's prone to dropping the axe on his administration, I don't think he can do much to influence Jerome Powell at this point. I'd like your thoughts on the yellow metal and silver. Technically, we like to think we've seen a washout. The greenback has come under a little bit of pressure. Do you think the worst is behind us?
Well, if the saying that adversity creates opportunity, Peter Grandich is taking the maximum effect from that. As we speak today, I have used the most recent declines to have the single largest, by far, holding in gold-related investments, and I find myself now, as we speak, with zero exposure to general equity. So if there's ever somebody that's been all in on the metals at this point, and certainly in his life, 35 years in and around the financial arena, it's me. So obviously I have a great bias to the bullish side. I, a couple days ago, reminded my readers where we were in 1979 when everybody thought the world was coming to an end, gold was breaking out and, you know, going to close to 1,000, which then was a tremendous move. And Business Week ran a front page story that basically said equities were dead. And I reminded our viewers we only then started to see almost a four-decade rally of financial assets, and hard assets take at best the best backseat, if not, you know, a substantial lagger. And now the feeling on my part was we're at one of those turns again, because equity seemed to be a sure bet by just about everybody. And there was even Krugman on a front page story saying gold is dead, that he even viewed Bitcoin as a better play than gold. So I just felt that, similar to where we were back in 79, we're at a major turn, and I've truly put my money where my mouth is, because my portfolio is just made up of gold and gold-related investments and no general equities at this time.
So you do agree then, at least with pure fundamental investors from their perspective, that this price-to-earnings ratio approaching 24, you know, the benchmark Standard & Poor's, is way beyond frothy. I mean, we're, what's the traditional, maybe 14, 15, maybe 16 on the price-to-earnings. So we're, you might say, a couple of standard deviations outside the norm. You think that eventually we could see a return to the mean on U.S. share prices?
Things that's tough now, Chris, is to use markets as they were 30 or 40 years ago and then use measures in this type of market. First of all, one of the biggest changes in the markets is who's participating. When I first entered the business in the early 80s, almost 90% of the daily trading, which then was on the New York Stock Exchange, which really now is just a museum and used for decoration for a financial network or two, now we have almost two-thirds of the trading being done by machines and software programs, which, you know, have no rhyme or reason to anything that an investor used to think of 30 or 40 years ago. So one thing is to use old measures in this market may not be the best thing to do. But still, from a valuation standpoint and really from a psyche standpoint, I'm really looking at it that we're rarely 180 degrees role reversal where we were 40 years ago. 40 years ago, equities were considered the worst place to be, and people were, you know, buying gold and prepared for it. You know, back then Japan was taking over the world. Now it's supposed to be China. And don't put any money in the general equity market. And you couldn't, I remember, just for a side note, starting as a broker, cold calling people with a 16% 10-year CD and people telling me it wasn't enough because rates had been recently up to 20%. So we're really turned, we're somewhere close to that 180-degree turn. Now the problem is you could stay at that point and not start to turn the other way a lot longer than you imagine. That's why I wouldn't be shorting the stock market, being long margined on gold. But I think building a position now in gold-related investments and disassociating myself in general equities, if someone still has an horizon that when I was in the business, people used to talk in times of years, now they talk in times of seconds and minutes of holding something. But if still someone invests for a matter of years, I think this is an excellent time to use the metals and what's transpired for whatever reason why we declined. And you can argue to the cows come home, but we do know now that we have the biggest short position that we've known. The stock market's at all-time highs. Realistically, gold should be near all-time lows because the very fact that gold still holds itself well above $1,000, a place that for decades we couldn't get above, actually bodes well too. So I don't think I'll see instantaneous gratification because I don't think gold's just going to skyrocket any moment. But I do think positioning one now self in gold and gold-related investments and precious metals, but gold leading the way, I think if one has a 3 to 5 year horizon still, I don't see how I get hurt in that.
You know, I'm a subscriber to your newsletter and your email blasts. I recall when Peter Granich and company essentially tossed in the towel, I want to say a year, year and a half ago, and said, you know, I really have to stick with diversified portfolio. And people who took your advice then have fared extremely well because the precious metals have lagged, most other sectors have lagged, but that equities component have done quite well. You know, the free lunch that Markowitz gave us 40, 50 years ago continues to work. However, you wish people could get their minds wrapped around that and just take 1% and toss the dice, 1-2% of their portfolios. Wanted to move on, though, to an interesting story that emerged from Bloomberg last week. Russia's added a lot of gold to its reserves in July, more than any other month this year. And the rumor has it that they're accumulating, and other central banks around the world are accumulating in anticipation, you might say front-running, the tariffs and the taxes out there. It's unnerving them. They know it's going to be difficult to procure the yellow metal because simply people don't want to pay the extra tax. And the Russian governor, Dmitry Tolin, made a really solid pitch to every investor out there. Gold is the only real guarantee against legal and political risks. That's a direct quote, legal, political risks. Jim Rickards, a good friend of the show, also said he thought it was a very smart move by Vladimir Putin there as well.
I think a lot of the positioning, both in China and Russia, is because an expectation of eventual replacement of the dollar as the world reserve base, and cover that those type of countries are going to have is the political distaste now they have towards America. I'm not here to argue what Trump is doing is right or wrong, but one thing that's clearly happening, it's shaken a lot of what would be called allies or even enemies. But I think it will give those people who have always wanted to move away from the U.S. dollar as a reserve currency the fodder they'll need for that. That Trump is an isolationist, he's not interested in the world, he's only interested in himself, and therefore we can't count on the American currency anymore, and we're seeing more news of deals being done without the dollar as the reserve base. So I really think that when they do get around to it, whatever is introduced will have some sort of gold backing to it to argue that, you know, why that new currency is the place to be and not a dollar that, you know, of a country that's, you know, people are getting all perturbed about and concerned about Turkey. We're just a bigger Turkey, and maybe that's, I don't mean it to be a pun, but we really are. We've dramatically lower interest rates. We've run up deficits through the moon. People don't seem here in America to think that there's a price to pay for it. And if for some reason the world moves away from dollars, and it seems to be heading at least in that direction, it will only add to the crisis that is only a matter of time that's coming to our shore. So I just think what they're doing is part of a move to eventually get a new world currency that will have some sort of mini or maximum gold support in it.
I think you almost alluded to the fact that we've been living, not just the Western world, but globally, where people throw caution to the wind, spend everything. I think the real tragedy will be the fact that because so many of our manufacturing, high-paying manufacturing jobs have been shipped offshore for the last 15 years, and we've lost on average 500,000 high-paying jobs a year for over a decade. 5 to 10 million solid jobs that are gone. And so people are strapped. You know, they have record credit card debt, record auto debt, of course, student loans. Add to that mortgages, interest rates going up. You talk to them about gold and they're like, what's it going to do for me? It's like having a life preserver, or better yet, a safety boat on the Titanic, which is slowly taking on water here.
One of the things that I say and try to leave my personal political and social views out of my work, but I take them into account to understand how they could play a role in what may happen to our finances. And one of the things I say when I hear the toss of we need to make America great again, I remind those who say that it is, well, in order to do that, you must remember that when it was great, or at least perceived great, we were the world's largest creditor nation. Now we're the world's largest debtor nation. Bring up even a more important point. What I see in my work is we do an alternative to traditional financial planning. We believe proving cash flow efficiencies is going to what's add to the bottom line of somebody not chasing net worth. And I will tell you, Chris, every three families or people we meet, one if not two of them are living at least one level, if not two or more, higher than their finances really should support. They're using debt and taking from their future in order to live a better lifestyle now. And I go in the opposite way. I have a less is more attitude. So what happens to one or two out of three is not only do they not like when I say what I say and haven't faced reality, but when they go down the street, so to speak, there's somebody similar to their thinking, which is easy. They stay in that lifestyle. And so never have we seen, we have one out of two people in America living on some sort of government support We now have statistics showing that one out of two Americans are struggling just to get the necessities of life, not the luxuries, but the necessities, food, water, shelter, and all. And the inevitable is that if there is a downturn, the only way the government can sustain that is to take from the people that still have something. No matter what, and I don't know the date, and, you know, it could be a lot further than I imagine, but it's not something that's just going to disappear and not be a problem. It gets acute the longer we don't deal with it, whether it's all the government benefits programs that are, you know, in huge problems to, like you said, you know, people have, the auto business is going to face a huge problem. People now are in 6 and 7 year car loans. You can't flip them. There's no way to take them out and sell them a new thing. I mean, there's just so many things, student loans, et cetera. But right now, like the tulip bulb mania in a little bit, people are willing to pay and not worry about it. My personal argument, and I know I never talked to you about this, and I'm not an expert, but part of the problems that I have with cryptocurrencies and Bitcoin, not the technology blockchain, but the actual is, one of the reasons it's doing well at the moment is there's a great demand. People are still having all these meetings all over. New money's coming into it. And a very small amount of group control most of the item people are buying. And that, you know, that's my opinion of one of the reasons they're able to still run. But eventually that could change. But yet people are living their life like that, and they're living for the moment, and they don't think there's a price to pay, and there will be. So the further we go in the markets without corrections and consolidations and things of that nature, when the inevitable term comes, the harder it will be to the downside.
You sparked some thoughts. I recently was reading through Alexis de Tocqueville, well-known French politician and political activist in the past, and he did considerable research, writing, you might say, on the American experiment and made some profound statements around the time of the American founders. And most people have probably at least heard some paraphrase of the fact, you know, America is great because she is good. And if America ever loses that goodness, we'll cease being great. That's just a quick paraphrase of it. He really covers a lot of areas and issues we're facing today. That's at the heart of it. If you add in the fiat money, it just always erodes the values that make a country great. It's not that it's all our fault. It's just when a society accepts this rottenness at the foundation of the money supply. So as we wrap up today, you know, any positive comments for folks? Do you see maybe some better times ahead for our precious metals aficionados?
I think in terms of the market, the stock market is pretty okay until we start to get past Labor Day, and then the focus will become on the election. And I have no doubt, and I underline no doubt, if the Democrats manage to at least take the House or even possibly the Senate control, if you think the anti-Trump movement is strong now, it will just be 100 times more, justifiably or not, is not what I'm here to talk about. But that in itself will be detrimental to a market that's really running on perfection, that needs perfection to stay in place in order to keep doing what it's doing. In terms of the gold market, what's interesting now, between now and the next labor report, the monthly employment report, will be critical to what gold does the rest of the year, in my opinion. We know we've had a bounce. People could argue it's just a dead cat bounce, and, you know, it's not surprising. We know that, as of the last statistics, that we still have record shorts. And I fully expect, at least maybe as we get to the end of this week when volume thins out, and certainly going into the employment number, where historically it seems every other employment number we have a raid on gold before it, I suspect that that group that's short is not going to go away without a fight. So don't be surprised that we have another substantial down day or two between now and a week from this Friday. But when it's all said and done and the dust clears after that unemployment, and they really don't have it back below the recent lows, and it's still at 1,200, even higher, then I think the shorts have a huge problem. And that's when that big short covering rally that people think is still going to come is going to happen, and we're going to rally back again. So we're not out of the woods yet, and I'm a guy that's be very hard to find somebody longer gold and gold-related with all their wealth as me. But I'm cautiously optimistic, and if you get me through that time frame, and I'm anywhere near $1,200 or higher, I think I can give the all-clear signal, and I think it'll be much better days ahead for gold.
Let's examine the other side of this balance sheet. Let's assume that, you know, these policies in place, the tariffs and whatnot, continue to improve exports. Our trading partners grow accustomed with the idea, okay, well, we have a leader here in place and we kind of respect the Machiavellian outlook. For whatever reason, the S&P 500 and the NASDAQ continue to print new highs. Can you come up with a scenario where the yellow metal, silver, and related shares perform well against that backdrop?
The only way it does it is, and you might have mentioned it when we first started speaking, that, you know, why isn't there some, you know, attrition of maybe 1 or 2% of what's currently in equities? I think that would be what you'll start to see. I think it's the main reason we stay here now. I think people have to understand that if you think that a paper market, which has just been absolutely raided on the short side, and effectively we're still in a trading range that we've been in several years, you know, 1,100 or so to the bottom and 1,350, 1,375 to the higher, there had to be some substantial physical buy-in in order to neutralize some of that shorting, or else we would just, you know, we would have had a $100 down day and the paper guys would be, you know, having their drinks down on Wall and Broad. But the bottom line is, I think that even if we were to keep going higher here, that there's enough still left, a few old-timers that have common sense that go, wait a minute, I'm looking at this thing, it's the longest bull market ever, valuations are really high. You know, soft data is starting to roll over, the economy, you know, even if you get the trade thing, it's, you know, we've seen the best of days, we got to pay a price, we're putting $1 trillion more in debt in the books each year. Maybe I should just err on the side of caution and treat what gold should be to everybody. And whether people are bullish or bearish, gold should be like home insurance or car insurance. Everybody I basically know has their home insurance and car insurance, not to see their car stolen or their home burnt down, but just in case it happens, you want to have something to offset it. Well, that's what gold should be now, given where financial assets are priced at and valuations are done. Buy a little gold and hope it doesn't go up, because if it goes up a lot, I can tell you one thing that happened. If you tell me, Pete, I saw the future, and gold prints in 2 years at 1,700 or 1,800, the Dow is in at 26 or 27,000. It's got a 1 now in front of it. And it's not a 2 or a 3. So own it, if nothing else, and hope it doesn't go up. But if you're like me and think there's value in it, then own it for capital appreciation as well.
Couldn't say it any better than that. If you could tell people more, please, about Peter Granich and Company.
Peter Granich and Company, the website is Peter Granich, GRANDICH.com, PeterGranich.com. We are an alternative to traditional financial planners because we focus on improving cash flow and not taking risk in trying to turn a dollar into 3, because most times 3 gets turned to 1. And we basically help people that are interested in retirement, estate planning, and business planning. Thank you, Chris.
It's a pleasure to welcome Nick Barashev back to the show, CEO of Bullion Management Group and author of $10,000 Gold, Why Gold's Inevitable Rise is the Investor's Safe Haven. I have two hard copies here, published, I think, in 2013. It's hard to believe it's been that long. Welcome back, Nick Barashev.
Thank you for inviting me.
Well, it's a pleasure to have you back with us, as always. $10,000 gold. Many people will say that's a lofty target from current levels. It sounds like good news for our precious metals aficionados.
There's $300 trillion of financial assets made up of stocks and bonds globally. And there is, in terms of above-ground, investment-grade bullion, i.e. bullion, not, you know, stuff in the Hermitage Museum and, you know, artwork and so on. But of actual bullion is about 1.8 trillion.
Okay, so less than 0.5%.
That's right. So the math is that in the 70s, the conservative allocation was 5% to gold. So if you take 5% of 300 trillion, you get 15 trillion.
Yep, tenfold increase from current levels.
And if you divide, you know, 15 by 1.8, you get $10,000 an ounce. So sooner or later, you get that number, but I think the number will be much higher, because when the market corrects, because we've got the first time that we've got a simultaneous triple bubble, when people panic from that correction, you'll get much, much higher than 5% allocation in gold.
Because not only is the typical portfolio incredibly light as far as gold allocation, you haven't even scratched the surface of the potential for investment. Yeah, people start to speculate on the prospects of runaway inflation, you know, circa the 1970s or currently in Venezuela, the Bolivar.
Well, currently, the canaries in the coal mine are more than just Venezuela. We've got Venezuela, Brazil, Argentina, Turkey, Iran, South Africa. So these are like the canaries in the coal mine. This is what's happening there for all the same failed monetary policy. And eventually that'll come to North America for the very same reasons. Print endless money and you can't go endlessly into debt.
But we're convinced that our economic soothsayers, you know, in their ivory towers have got it all figured out this time. After all, you know, Nick Barish, if they have supercomputers, algorithms, and different economic models.
Where we've got a much bigger problem than 2008 is that the margin debt now is 50% higher than 2008. So when this market corrects and you get margin calls, the slide is going to be very fast.
Just to illustrate how quickly this all can unfold, even in Western civilizations, Venezuela is my favorite, not just Venezuela, but we haven't even discussed India, where, the prime minister essentially overnight said, you know, I don't care for currency anymore and circulation, let's just go digital. These things can happen abruptly, and who knows? I mean, could we all wake up and the U.S. dollar has been devalued overnight, you know, by half, and everything in our bank account buys half as much as before?
Well, this is where, like, China, Russia, Iran, Turkey are buying gold, you know, in preparation for this, because the aim for them is to dethrone the U.S. dollar as the world's reserve currency eventually.
Or one might maybe look at it from another perspective and say they're simply preparing for the inevitable devaluation of the U.S.
Right,
currency.
That's right.
To listen to some of our officials and policymakers disparage China, if one finds a systemic illness, you know, within a currency market, I think inoculating your own currency with precious metals or gold seems like a prudent, you know, idea.
Exactly. The issue with China, like Russia publishes its gold purchases and been considerable. In the case of China, they buy their gold through their sovereign wealth fund that doesn't report to anybody. And the gold in the central bank is static at 1,600 tons. So they move the gold from the sovereign wealth fund to the central bank when it suits them.
And the irony is we have over half of Americans, and I don't say this lightly or with any glib in my voice at all, I hope, but half of U.S. households are receiving some type of government assistance. Approximately 96 million able-bodied Americans have given up or have just stopped looking for work altogether. That's one out of three, approximately. And so one wonders if the monetary spigots or the handouts were to suddenly, let's just say, halt for whatever reason, maybe a temporary government shutdown, some other unforeseen event.
Right. The issue is that the mainstream media, all they do is they harp on the fact that the stock market's rising and the unemployment rate is low. But if you go to shadowstats.com, which gives you truer numbers, the actual unemployment rate is 22%.
Yes, you're exactly right. John Williams has been an excellent friend of the show over 13 years here. He does a truer measure of the GDP, actual price levels in the United States, and he points out that as long as these price levels are held artificially low, it seems to inflate the actual gross domestic product or our national output, which benefits, you know, whoever's in office to the disadvantage of 300 million Americans.
Now, the other thing that most people aren't aware of, but it's been implemented and done, is that under Basel III, the BIS rules call for gold being a zero-risk asset equal to treasuries or cash for a bank's balance sheet. That in the mainstream media ever?
Can you tell us what you feel the implications of this are?
Well, it's just that, you know, the banks can then, you know, now hold, you know, gold instead of treasuries and have the same effect on their balance sheet. That's the thing. Up till now, it was considered like a high-risk asset, and that's why the banks, you know, didn't hold it. but now they can hold it, just like they hold cash or treasuries.
Even the money purveyors have become so deluded with their own rhetoric that they themselves are actually consuming the proverbial Kool-Aid.
Yeah, but they've just done it, you know, quietly, and it doesn't appear in the mainstream media. But those rules have been implemented in all the Western countries.
Then when the music stops, which it always has done throughout, you know, financial history, let's just say the last 400 years, but we can go back to ancient Greece and Rome as well, and even earlier. But so when the music eventually stops, the safety valve has essentially been gutted here because our central bankers won't even have the ammunition necessary to stop the inevitable destruction. You've mentioned that peak gold production could also be an important supply component that might send price higher. Are you sticking with that outlook?
Yeah, it looks like gold production has peaked, and plus the thing is that if you discover gold, it'll take you 20 years to get the mine into production. So even if you were to have a huge find today, it wouldn't do you any good for 20 years in terms of supply.
The other compelling argument there regarding gold is, unlike silver, it tends to be identified deeply in the Earth's crust. And so even if we were to find another El Dorado-like potential mine, the effort to procure it is Herculean.
That's right. Like if the gold price rises because of sort of safe haven demand, mine supply isn't going to have any effect. There won't be any increase in mine supply.
The comments from the People's Bank of China regarding a convertible yuan into gold. This actually involves crude oil.
That's being established and implemented. So if you're a oil producer, say, like Iran, you can sell your oil to China in yuan, and then on the Shanghai Gold Exchange, convert the yuan to gold and sell the oil for gold.
So let's bring all the pieces of this intriguing puzzle together. If I understand you correctly, you're saying that the yuan essentially has at least a modicum of gold backing and, more importantly, convertibility with petroleum. They also now have a military that's starting to rival any other in the world. 500,000 of our high-paying manufacturing jobs have left our shores for theirs over the last decade. That's 5 million jobs. And they're the manufacturing superpower of the world.
China and Russia have publicly stated that their objective is to displace the U.S. dollar as the world's reserve currency into something else. Maybe an SDR, maybe a petrol yuan, maybe whatever. But the Russia and China don't like the exorbitant privilege that the U.S. has by having the world's reserve currency. Everybody else has got to do something to make a living where the U.S. can just print the money. No other country can do that.
Okay, that, I guess, is one of the unintended benefits of having a reserve currency. But, of course, when the music stops, what would be the chief means of employment? Do we look to Great Britain, the former reserve currency, the pound there, as an example?
Well, it could be Great Britain, and can be looking at what's happening in Venezuela, like or Argentina. These were all, in the past, relatively, you know, good, strong economies.
Do you expect this endgame to unfold as it did in Venezuela? Seemingly overnight, in just about 12 months' time, a loaf of bread is at least 1 million bolivar.
Right.
John Williams, of course, Shadow Stats agrees with you, many of our others. But, you know, I know there will be the listener and the subscriber who says, you know, Chris, we've heard this for almost 20 years. Is this one of those moments where crying wolf is actually prudent?
The average performance of gold in all the currencies over the past 10 years is 10%. All the currencies, and what the return is, you get 10% over 10 years. So, number two, regardless of anything else, gold is the most negatively correlated asset to financial assets, meaning gold goes one way when stocks and bonds go the other way. In order to have the least risky portfolio, you need to have 10 to 20% in gold. So that way, when the stock and bonds correct, the gold goes up and vice versa. So you just hold 10 to 20%. You don't need a cataclysm for this to be justified. Put 10 to 20% in and forget about it. And you'll have a lower volatility, higher return portfolio. That's that. If gold goes to 10,000 an ounce, you'll be laughing. And if it doesn't, then you haven't lost anything. You've still improved your portfolio.
Exactly. And then I assume, though, that you were a bit wary of exotic precious metals instruments, such as ETFs.
Can't be in anything like that. It's got to be physical gold that you either own or is in custodial allocated storage, and there's a lot to check out there if you're going to store it. Depends on how much gold you're going to need to buy. If you're going to buy millions of dollars worth of gold, it's not practical to keep it at home.
So what are some of the obvious risks that investors should keep in mind?
Gold isn't any different than cars, boats, houses, or anything else, okay? So to own something, you have to have a transfer of title that specifically identifies the asset. So in the case of a car, it's make, model, serial number, et cetera. So I list those things, and I convey them to you. In the case of gold, I need to have the refiner, the serial number, the exact weight, and the exact purity, okay? And that specifically then is conveyed to me. It's not good enough to get a statement that says, I own so many ounces. That means you own nothing. Unless you have the serial numbers and so on and so forth for the exact bars, you don't own any bullion.
You're thinking a few moves ahead on the chessboard that when the music stops, people will only be, you know, safe at night if they've made sure the serial number of each coin or bar is registered with the storage facility.
Right, now. Coins don't have serial numbers, so you have to create a storage container with a serial number for coins so you can do that. But the second thing that people aren't aware of also is the storage facility. So, like, you can own allocated gold, but if the storage facility, the vault, defaults on either its mortgage or its debt, and a trustee is appointed, the trustee is going to say, prove to me that you own the gold, okay? And if you can't prove to them that you own the gold, it goes into the bankruptcy pile. What you've got to do is you've got to do a lot of due diligence on the custodian, financial statements and so on, and you've got all kinds of people storing gold. Well, they could default on that. The powers of a trustee in bankruptcy are considerable, okay? And that's what happens if there's a default on either the mortgage or the lease, and a trustee is appointed. The objective of the trustee is to get as much gold as possible into the bankruptcy pile.
Because they're looking to cover as much of their losses as possible.
Your listeners should just consider the fact that if they own gold, they've got a portfolio that's less volatile and less risky than without it. And gold goes to 10,000 an ounce, well, it's not going to be a pleasant place on earth to be.
Folks who were just able to put aside a few gold coins in Caracas just 12, 18 months ago. I mean, could you even fathom what could be purchased with those coins today? Doesn't it remind one of the stories we hear from friends and family in the Weimar, you know, Republic or after the World Wars in Central Europe?
That's right. That's where the kind of the insurance aspect of it comes in, so.
It's an almost impossible forecast or prediction to make because we don't know how governments will react. We don't know what measures they might try to use. They're certainly fighting the inevitable currency collapse in every way they can think of. Do you, like some people, think that by 2022 things could be unraveling quickly?
I think they could be unraveling quickly this fall. I mean, I can't see the market hanging in there when we've got bubbles of this proportion. Things are going to start unwinding there, and when it does, that's when the flood to gold will happen.
With rates so low for so long, and of course negative all over, especially in Asia right now and parts of Europe, with such artificially low rates, the U.S. having pretty much turned its back on QE, and now Europe and China talking about wrapping up QE, what would our officials and policymakers really have in place to battle the bubble implosions that you're talking about?
If the market crashes, they'll have to reverse their position and reinstitute QE.
And that, of course, leads to enormous sums of helicopter drops.
That's right.
If we do have that crack-up boom moment, then I guess you would first envision prices out of control and then global economy just shutting down for a while?
It could at some point in time, like people are going to not know what to trade in. We're already having problems when we're transferring, when investors are transferring money to, you know, buy bullion from us. That's already becoming a problem.
Tell people more about BMG Group and some of the services you provide, please.
Well, we have three mutual funds, like a gold, silver, platinum mutual fund, a gold only mutual fund, a silver only mutual fund. And then we also sell a wide variety of bullion bars and coins that people can either take delivery or we can store it for them at Brinks in Toronto, Montreal, Calgary, Vancouver, Hong Kong, Dubai, Singapore, Geneva, and Panama. So you take your pick where you want it stored.
Then some of the advantages of BMG, please.
We're pure gold. We don't compromise the gold. Just facilitate it for investors and make it happen. Thanks again for having me on your show.
Well, you know, Nick Bereshef, we appreciate your thoughts and want to encourage everyone today to direct their web browsers to Bullion Management Group. We'll have links all over our websites at GoldSeek, and looking forward to hearing your next set of interesting insights on the financial markets as well as the precious metals, which we hope are finding a bottom here, maybe a capitulation.
Yeah, I think we're pretty close to that point. So the book is available on Amazon and Kindle, so it gives people a good basic overview of money and gold and how everything works. So I encourage them. That would be a good starting point.
And would you say now that 3 or 4 years after its publishing that you feel the projection might have been overly conservative?
Well, yeah, because the debt has continued to go up.
Thank you, sir. Please return to the show.
Okay, bye now.
GoldSeek.com Radio. Reuters, The Financial Times, Zero Hedge, and countless other news outlets recently disseminated a story on how Germany is planning to call for a global payment system independent of the U.S. Germany's Foreign Minister Heiko Maas recently advocated for the creation of a new payments system independent of the U.S. that would allow Brussels to be independent in its financial operations from Washington, and he said, as a means of rescuing the nuclear deal between Iran and the West. But is that statement from Germany more political or economically based? SWIFT, you'll recall, stands for Society for Worldwide Interbank Financial Telecommunication. It's currently comprised of over 11,000 banks in over 200 countries. SWIFT transactions are actually settled, not just in dollars, but in over 25 global currencies. A discussion by Martin Armstrong on this subject last year outlined that Visa International supports approximately 180 transaction currencies, which enables the processing of international transactions, not exclusively dollars, all through the SWIFT system. According to that discussion, 26 currencies can be used in the net settlement between Visa International and the SWIFT system's participating members, with the choice of currency being decided by each member involved in the settlement. You may recall many discussions in 2013 and 2014 that Russia was developing its own alternative to the SWIFT system. However, a CNBC report in May of 2018 that quoted Russia's central bank chief, Elvira Nabalina, as saying, "Since back in 2014, we have been developing our own systems, including a payments system. Inside Russia, we have created a system for transferring financial data, which is similar to SWIFT." Doubts about the veracity of that system have called it not very credible and not realistic for dealing with Western partners. China's SIPS system has been touted as a replacement for the SWIFT system, but that hasn't come to pass either. In the absence of credible economic arguments, is Mr. Maas making political threats disguised as economic arguments? Time will tell. In the meantime, however, the Financial Times has commented that the EU has vowed to protect European businesses from punitive measures adopted by Washington. But that same European Union has also failed to convince European Union companies who are more concerned about maintaining their access to the lucrative U.S. market than in the more modest opportunities presented by Iran to side with them in placing politics over economics. The classic battle between business and politicians. I wonder who's going to win this one. Stay tuned. And until next time, this is Robert Ian with ConquerChange.com. Thanks, Chris.
Okay, Robert, thanks for another excellent installment. Well, that wraps up this week's GoldSeek.com radio episode. For two new big guests, be sure to check out next week's show. Until we talk to you again, have a great week.